Good morning. It is early here in Feasterville. Just 8 a.m., but we are here to bring you one of the first bouts of the third day of ECDX 2019. This is a level 3 junior roller derby bout.
Just like adults. I watched an adult/junior scrimmage a couple weekends ago, and they can hold their own against those
adults. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I called an incredible bout yesterday morning between Queen City and Gotham Junior, also level 3. Mm-hmm. What incredibly talented athletes, and I expect we'll see a lot of the same. And Yes. This is your home junior team.
It is. This is the Raleigh Junior Rollers. They are my family, I think.
Although I don't live there anymore, I did live in Philly for quite a while, so this is my semi-home team, too.
So we've got some emotional connections here with teams taking the track.
I'm going to go ahead. We've got about a minute till Derby and announce to you who is playing and coaching for the Philly Roller Derby Junior All-Stars. We have number 101, Ty Fighter, 13, Sugar Cookies, 15, Motley Drew, 17, Take Down Diva, 20, Dirty Dan, 28, Bonnet, 3, Rainbow Bash, 31, Susan B. Anarchy, 409, Vegematic, 50, Unstoppable, 80, Eye of the Storm, 817, Boomerang, 888, Harley Spin, 9, Megalass, 99, Wild One, and coaching Philly today is Teflon Donna, Devoid of Mercy, Tomahawk, and Built to Spill.
And skating for Raleigh Junior Rollers is 05 Shortcut Team Co-Captain, 112 Yeti, 138 Hankenweenie, 145 Sir Walter Rowley, number 151 Fina Colada, 20 Adrenaline Junkie, 222 Assassinator Team Co-Captain, 26 Thrilla Camilla, 29 Els Bells, 411 Madison, 676 Squishy, 775 Prim Reaper, 777 Lightning Lauren, 8008 Ruby Katubi, and 934 Throat Punch Thursday, coached today by Walter Cation and Daisy Rage.
And I mentioned this yesterday, in Junior Derby 1, slight difference is that they still do gear checks on the skaters just to make sure that everyone is as safe as possible, and we super appreciate that. Adults, you know, we assume can take care of themselves, make sure they're safe, but with the juniors, we really want to make sure.
And we will do a gear check again after halftime because, as we know, there's some hard hits happening on the track, so they'll do a gear check after halftime as well.
And some things to know about Junior Roller Derby, there are levels. There's level 1, level 2, level 3. Level 3, of course, being the highest level. Mm-hmm. And there's very little difference between level 3 Junior Roller Derby and Adult Roller Derby as we know it.
Yeah, and there is. They use the Wftda rule set with a few minor adjustments for the age difference. But you know, gameplay is just exactly alike.
Yeah.
You know?
Another really awesome thing, in my opinion, I think it's an incredible piece of roller derby, is there is a co-ed division or an all-gender division of junior roller derby and a female division of junior roller derby. This particular bout is considered to be an all-gender.
All-gender, that's right.
And I just think that is really incredible and phenomenal, because I remember growing up and everybody said we couldn't play with the boys, everybody had to be separate, and roller derby has really shown that's not true.
Right, and it's a very high contact sport, and everybody is in there giving it their all, and they can give as good as they can take, right?
Right, and not to mention, when we say all gender, we really do mean that folks who identify as non-binary, trans, whatever, really, all are welcome.
Yes,
here,
absolutely,
in the in this division of roller derby. So that's a great outlet. Philly circling up down there. I think you can see them too. They have some very well-known names here coaching Philly juniors: Teflon Donna, Devoid of Mercy, Built to Spill. All very common names, household names at one point for the Philly Roller Girls.
So if you're on an adult league and you happen to be watching this game, you know, if you get someone, so speaking of which, there are three skaters on Raleigh Junior Rollers that are we aging out. That's number 05 Shortcut, number 222 Assassinator, number 676 Squishy. if you're on an adult league, you want to recruit these folks because they've been skating for
years,
8, 10 years before they get to you, and playing derby for that long. And so they are quite good.
And 18 years old is the,
right? Yeah, it's 18. When they turn 18, they're allowed to finish out that year whenever they turn 18, because it might not fall, you know, miraculously on the month that you need it to. So they're allowed to play for the remainder of that year, and then they will age up to another one.
All right, we are about ready to get started here in Feasterville. On the line for Philly, I actually could not see the number there.
So, yeah, that is Bonnet, right? Yeah, Bonnet. And Ruby Katubi wearing the star for Raleigh Junior Rollers.
And Bonnet is out, takes a little hit to the shoulder, but able to scoot right through. That's four on the board for Bonnet here in Philadelphia.
Ruby looking for a space and does get out on one blocker to beat and does get out on the initial. So that'll call the force the call off from Bonnet, but not before. Oh, no. No, she did not call it off.
Bonnet,
I'm sorry.
Bonnet looked over to Teflon Donna. Teflon Donna said, keep on going. Bonnet nodded and did just what coach said.
And that is
also
what you want in a player,
hit.
Right?
That's a high block on Philly's jammer here. It looks like maybe she didn't really know where the penalty box was.
Well, every track, just if you're not in the venue, every track is a little different setup. And so the penalty box are in completely different corners. So
that was a high block on number 28 Bonnet, which gives Raleigh a power jam.
Yeah. And we will run the remainder of this 43 seconds jam since the lead was rescinded.
Yeah, and this pass will, upon completion, tie up the score. Unless, which she might, Bonnet might have some points in the pocket there upon returning to the track.
Now, I think that the reason Philly wanted to run this is because the defense is really effective against Ruby Katubi's jamming style here. And so the coach knew, hey, we can pick up some points here because Ruby's unable to contend with that defense as it sets up.
Totally. And that's always sort of the risk. When you run it, like, your jammer could commit a penalty.
Right.
There's no correct path, really, in roller derby. There's just sort of choose your own adventure.
Right. Now, I think Ruby did have some there in that last pass, even though she didn't get through the pack, but...
Yep, I think three.
When we shake down, it's 7-16, so great run by Philly on that jam.
Can you believe it? That was our first
jam. I know, right? Two-minute jam already.
Run. Yes. Okay, here we go. Number five... Is that 15, Motley Drew?
Looks like Unstoppable. 50.
It is Unstoppable around. Here.
And that is Madison 411.
So it's about a half a track split between these two jammers. Unstoppable is approaching the pack and to try and score these points. I saw him pass at least two hips.
Yeah. Coming into that triangle, but Madison out and trying to force that call off and does.
And it is two up there for Unstoppable and Philly, bringing them to 18. I know most of the folks watching know derby pretty well, but the way you score points is getting past an opponent's hips.
Mm-hmm. And just for our viewers.
If you're a jammer.
Correct, yeah. If you're watching the feed, you have this really great, I really appreciate the folks that are out here. Sponsored by the Derby Apex.
Yes.
But we don't have the view that you have.
No.
So we are looking at the front of the jam line, and so we don't often see the jammers until they come back around turn one here. That is number 20, Dirty Dan, wearing the star for Philly.
And almost had lead and then got drawn back, but is able to reclaim it for Philadelphia.
And that's 9-3-4, Throat Punch Thursday, wearing the star for Raleigh.
The pack going pretty fast and is pretty chaotic down there right now. Mm-hmm. And Dirty Dan, who is the captain here for Philly today, was able to pick up four on that pass.
Lots of people falling, everybody getting up. Squishy making a little shoulder.
Oh, a really nice swoop to the outside by Dirty Dan to score four more there. Raleigh needs to work on getting their jammer out here.
Yeah, the Philly defense, I got to say, give them credit. They are swarming the jammer. So even when there is a hole opened up, they immediately close it.
It's a low block on one of the Philly blockers there. And, you know, I will say that is very true to Philly adult roller derby. Man, you do not want to get caught up in that defense.
Right. And they're really showing that here as Dirty Dan makes it through for another scoring pass.
That's 16 so far. This pass will make it 20 if he completes it.
So we do have a star pass, and that is to Shortcut, team co-captain.
Good. So that may be able, yes, to help them stop the bleeding on this particular jam. Mm. We'll see how many he picked up in that last, which is three. Bringing Philly Junior Rollers to 37, Raleigh Juniors to 7, so that's a 30-point difference. But let's remember that 19 of those points just came.
Right.
In one jam.
In one jam. We're sitting right under 24 and a half minutes. And this is the first half. This is the first game. First half, first game.
Of the day.
Of the day for the last day of ECDX 2019.
This is Bonnet. The pack is spread out. Two blockers at the front for Raleigh.
And that was Sir Walter Rowley picking up a penalty there and, not knowing where the penalty box is, skated past the penalty box.
You know, one thing that I learned from some folks is that when you're warming up, always go and sit over in the penalty box. Just quickly get the view, make sure you know where it is before the bout starts. Bonnet with a nice juke.
We're looking, we do have a penalty tracker here on the stream, and they have not recorded a penalty for Sir Walter Rowley, and I did not see the call, and so we'll just wait and see. They're probably conferring with one another and putting the penalty up there. So
Rowley has completed a star pass to Prim Reaper, but that Philly defense is really locking down number 817 Boomerang, bubbling back to make sure that Prim Reaper cannot go anywhere.
And they're doing a great job locking Prim down. So we've got lots of bodies headed to the penalty box.
I think it's a power jam for Philly. Let's take a look here at what that call was on the jammer, because I missed it.
There's so much happening. Many bodies headed to the penalty box.
So for Bonnet number 28, that is their second. Her second, it's a low block.
Low block. There we go. So we might have a couple seconds difference between when they recorded in the penalty box and when it comes up on our tracker, but it's certainly useful to have this information for us so we can provide it to you.
And unfortunately, Raleigh just not able to capitalize on this power jam, again, due to that Philly defense.
And look at that.
Yep, on a scoring pass.
So that's Yeti in the box. And had the star in his hand, it looks like. So that was the jammer in the box. So the 1-1-12.
Right, 1-1-12 had passed it then to the Prim Reaper.
To Prim Reaper, right, gotcha. A lot happening.
There is. No one is sitting in the box right now, though,
the
to start
this clear.
Jam.
So that is a positive thing.
Philly rushing back to the jam line.
So that's Wild One around the outside with wearing the star for Philly off the Frogmouth jam line. Picking up lead jammer, but this is Madison also out of the pack.
Nice. So Philly going to try to pick up a quick points here, but Madison with a nice jump over the leg of one of the Philly blockers and actually through the pack first for all four. Nice job by Wild One. That's Madison.
Wild One is the...
Oh, my. Another beautiful jump by Madison. That's another four. That's 8 points for Raleigh, giving them a little bit of steam here.
Yeah. A little bit. I think when Madison has, having seen her play before, when she has a little bit of space to get in her stride, she's quite good. But that Philly defense has been really good so far and effective when she's had the star to lock her down And it's just, I can't say enough good things about the defense here for Philly.
Right. If you're at a standstill in a wall, it's, that's a different kind of jamming than kind of having your space, being able to take those jumps.
Yeah, I mean, yes, you know, she's very
this is
calm
Susan.
And she can just do it, but you have to have the space to do it. So Raleigh getting stretched out here at the front. I interrupted you. I'm sorry.
Oh, no, that's okay. I was just going to say it's Susan B. Anarchy, who is jamming for Philly and is also lead.
It's Throat Punch Thursday again with the star for Raleigh.
And not a bad idea trying to catch just some leverage here. Oh, dear, Philly, number 31, the jammer. Susan B. Anarchy is going to the box. It looks like that is a back block here, which gives Raleigh another power jam. Let's see if they can work really hard to capitalize here.
Now, Raleigh is doing the motions of trying to break up Philly for the jammer and throwing a lot of hips and shoulders and trying to break up that defense, but Philly's just so effective at getting back in there.
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure. So this will be a two-minute jam because, of course, Susan B. Anarchy was lead, and that privilege gets rescinded upon a penalty and entering the box.
Oh,
that was
beautiful. A beautiful spin, yeah. Stayed on the line, inbounds. So Throat Punch still on the initial pass and does get out of the pack. So that is the initial. Finally, after a full power jam.
Yeah. You know, and sometimes it's hard against these tough walls because when you're going into play offense, you're actually just creating kind of more people for the jammer to get past.
Mm-hmm.
It's just sometimes can feel like a no-win situation.
A nice shot there by TIE Fighter. Just want to point out, pushing Raleigh forward to try to keep them from coming back and breaking up that pack. Throwing an extra person out there instead of a brace wall. They just have the three wall with the extra person doing a little interference. It's a great move.
Totally. We actually call that person extra.
Extra. I like it.
Philly Juniors at 67, Raleigh Juniors at 16 here going into jam or coming out of jam six. But we have a timeout on the track by Raleigh. They're going to collect themselves.
Right,
maybe think about what they can do to use those power jams to their advantage a little bit better. Maybe catch their breath. We do want to give a shout out to Frogmouth, who creates, makes, produces, dresses many folks here in the roller derby community in uniforms, hoodies, crop top hoodies, helmet covers.
Right.
And Frogmouth is one of our sponsors this year. So if you don't know the kind of uniforms Frogmouth makes, you should check them out. They're really incredible.
Mm-hmm.
And there's such a variety.
You can't be in the derby community and not know Frogmouth, right? That name it's on all of the clothes. So we do have, just, you know, as we're waiting here for this to wrap up, Philly has gone to the box quite a bit more than Raleigh.
Quite a bit.
So more than twice as much. And so Raleigh playing a clean game so far, even though they haven't been able to put the points on the board. But Philly has spent quite a bit of time in that penalty box.
Now let's see.
So that definitely is Shortcut wearing the star. That's the team captain, the one who's going to age out. So recruiters, take a look.
Having a hard time. They're number 13, that sugar cookies for Philly. And Philly has used many of their skaters to jam here.
Yeah.
Raleigh has stuck to a little bit more of a
small rotation. Sugar cookies. Barely staying in bounds there, but manages to spin around on one foot. And
it's a direction of gameplay on Philly's pivot.
And that is a penalty assessed for Shortcut. As soon as I say they've been staying out of the box, looks like a back block was assessed for Shortcut. And so this will be a power jam for Philly.
Philly swarming and trying to hold that Raleigh defense off of their jammer, Sugar Cookies. But the pivot for Raleigh is able to draw Sugar Cookies back and force her to re-enter the gauntlet. Power Jam is over for Raleigh, and Shortcut, yes, with a nice absorption of the hit and able to get through there.
So that is the initial, and now a penalty will be assessed to Sugar Cookies.
Did you see what it was?
Let's see.
Yeah.
Looks like they'll put it on the board here. No, so the jam clock down past 15 seconds, and so.
Yeah, Raleigh's going to start on a power jam. That was four up there for Shortcut. Going to try and score a few more before this clock runs out. I think he got all four.
Yeah, we'll see.
Three.
The jam.
No, only two, really?
Two.
Still out a nice change, able to put some points on the board,
exactly,
is what I'm trying to say.
Yes, and keep Philly to a reasonable level, right?
Yes.
So even though we had a power jam for both sides.
It was a track cut call on Sugar Cookies to land her in the box as the jammer for Philly in the past jam.
So standing right now is Sugar Cookies in the penalty box. We've got Madison jamming.
A smart move there for Raleigh to put Madison on the line. Close.
Almost made it out, but just
that
stepped out of bounds.
That should be lead right there, I thought, but maybe not. Maybe not past the hips quite. Madison fighting hard at the top of the pack.
Yeah, that Philly defense is. And the pack now getting a little spread out. We're going to have to start bridging.
Yes.
But here comes Sugar Cookies up the inside, picks up a lead jammer.
And, you know, that is the danger of pulling a jammer back too far, not being able to reset your wall. And then a fast and a sort of jukey jammer can exploit that.
So, again, that was TIE Fighter with that little hit and a drawback on Madison. Madison with the star in hand.
Yes, looking maybe to their pivot number 112, Yeti, for a little bit of help out there. But in the meantime, Sugar Cookies.
Yep.
Around for another scoring pass. That's eight on the board so far here in this jam for Sugar Cookies and Philadelphia. And unfortunately.
Yes. Oh, no.
Raleigh's pivot going in the box, which means Madison is on her own with a beautiful turnaround jump.
Yeah. And
that
TIE
is out
Fighter,
of play
yeah.
there.
TIE Fighter is just everywhere, all over the track out there. And I do believe we have an official review.
Yes,
called by.
Called by Raleigh.
Raleigh.
I think.
I believe you are correct. As so, Coach Daisy Rage is already on the middle of the track, I'm assuming that she's called.
Yes. Which probably means she knows exactly what she wants.
What she wants to say, yes.
That's 86 to 22. We should also let you know that we are approaching sort of prime derby season here.
Yes.
We have playoffs coming right up. This is actually one of the last tournaments of sort of the regular season in WFTDA play. We start August 9th through 11th with the Continental Cup North America West in Orem, Utah. August 23rd through 25th, the Continental Cup North America East, that's in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, right around the corner here from Feasterville. September 6th through 8th, International playoffs in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, September 13th through 15th. We also have playoffs in Seattle, Washington, and this is really cool. October 5th and 6th, it's the Continental Cup Europe in Helsinki, Finland. November 15th through 17th, International WFTDA Championships in Montreal, Quebec, Canada. Get your tickets as soon as possible.
Right. They really are selling quickly. And I would love to go to any and all of these.
Yes. Do you
know if
you
can't afford it?
Yeah.
But, I mean,
I live in Maine, and so I did already buy my tickets to Montreal I don't need to fly there. I can either drive, take the bus.
Nice. It is, you know, WFTDA really does try to spread
diversify,
things out a little
yeah.
bit so that people don't have to travel quite so far, but some folks still have to travel quite a bit.
Els Bell's wearing the Jammer star for the first time for Raleigh.
That's unstoppable, wearing the star for Philly, and unstoppable has been unstoppable so far with a star.
And so that was a big hit, but that was legal contact to the side of number 05 on Raleigh, Shortcut.
And Els Bell strewed the middle and picks up a track cut. We'll head to the penalty box as a power jam for unstoppable.
So there's two actually in the box, one blocker and the jammer for Raleigh. Only three to beat here for unstoppable.
Unstoppable has put up a couple of big jam. I mean, well, this would be the second big jam for unstoppable in the double digits. So living up to his name.
Yeah, incredibly, really able to just be hit and not go anywhere. Mm-hmm. Creating a path for himself that is relatively unstoppable.
Yeah, I mean, can so when a player, and I have seen that was Prim Reaper at the last blocker that Unstoppable had to beat. I've seen Prim run one-on-one defense. She can do it, but something about Unstoppable's method has
yeah, very
blown past.
Totally. A very unique way of skating. It might be like sort of a hockey hybrid,
yeah.
But really great. That was a 24-point jam for Unstoppable, bringing us to 110-22 here in favor of the Philly Rollers. But a couple of those really, as you just mentioned, at least 30 points, I believe, of those of Philly's points did have come from Unstoppable.
So this is actually a smart move strategically for Philly to start with a power start and keep Els on the track with the star for Raleigh. It may not work out in their favor because she was
yes.
able to pop right about because she was having a little trouble with the defense, so it's not a bad idea to keep her on the track for a second jam, but she was able to cut right through there.
Let's see. I think it's a 1-1 maybe.
Maybe.
No? None. Two.
They're putting two on the board for Philly. Zero
but
for Raleigh.
I did see a signal of. Nope, never mind. Also, just of note, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different skaters have worn the star for Philly. That is. That's a lot.
Mm-hmm. And I was bragging on Raleigh's clean game, but now we're about even with the number of penalties, how many times. People, so they're trading off a little bit here as we tick down under the 11-minute mark here in the first half.
That, of course, is Bonnet.
And Madison wearing the star for Raleigh.
These two skaters have a bit of a similar style here, so it's kind of nice to see them go against one another.
Yeah.
A really nice X, like.
Oh, I'm not sure that Madison was able to get through there, but full 4 points picked up for Bonnet.
And what Bonnet did really was already skating fast and then really turned on the gas mm-hmm. to get past those final two blockers to pick up all four.
But both of them, I love, their skating is sort of smooth. And,
really?
You know, when they come, they just have these really smooth crossovers and it's...
super
yeah,
skilled
right.
and fast
yeah,
skaters.
Right, yeah. They're using every inch efficiently.
Susan B. Anarchy is your lead jammer for Philadelphia. Ruby Katubi, is this the first time? Ruby Katubi's jammed one other time here for Raleigh.
And likewise, this time, Ruby had a hard time with the defense the first time she came out, and this time is no different. Oh!
Yeti with a nice block to the inside on Ruby Katubi. No, I'm sorry, on... is it...
And,
did I say that was? That's number 31. That's Susan B. Anarchy.
Yeah. Wow. Just lots of hard hitting in there. They are locking down Ruby Katubi. That is Eye of the Storm and Boomerang. They've locked her right in there, and she is unable.
Oh, number 334 on Raleigh. Or actually, is that 934?
Throat punch, yeah.
Yes, that was almost legit a throw punch.
So, yeah, we saw a throat punch Thursday wearing the star earlier, but you can see here probably all direction.
Is going to the box there.
It was out the late hit, maybe. I said direction, but that's not correct. That's not the hand motion he was making. But
Number 31, the jammer for Philly has gone to the box. Susan B. Anarchy. Let's take a look at what that call is going to be. Number 31, Backblock.
I think that may have
been their first.
Yeah, let's wait a second
sure.
to see if it resets here. Yeah, lots of people heading to the box here, in and out. I'm not sure that Ruby Katibi was able to put any points there for Raleigh on that pass.
But they will start. They will have at least a couple of seconds on a power jam. And, you know, if I was going to talk to this Raleigh team as a coach, I might say, you know, they're going for these really big hits.
Mm-hmm.
And what that does is that splits them away from their people. So maybe try and lock in a little bit of a slower game where you can touch your other blockers mm-hmm. rather than going in for those big hits and see if that might shift a little bit
right.
and your ability to catch. Because Philly's jammers are sly.
Mm-hmm. And, yeah, I think when you go for the big swing,
mm-hmm.
that you're now out. Like, you're now not using – unless you know for a fact you can land it mm-hmm. and make a difference, a big swing is just not an efficient way to use your body or your momentum,
right.
actually. So that would be.
And we did get, it was actually a cut track call on the jammer that is standing
yes.
For Philly. And we have an official review now by Philly Junior coaches.
The other official review that was called by Raleigh, we don't have information on that one, but we know it, what they did not win the official review,
right.
or they would not retain the official
and,
review.
Right, exactly. And so when you don't win it, which means that you've said, hello, referees, we think that you either missed a call or mm-hmm. miscalled something. If they decide, no, like, we had it right the mm-hmm. first time, you do lose that review. If, however, upon review, they say, yep, you know, we have reviewed that, we've looked at it, I checked in with, you know, my outside pack ref, mm-hmm. and we agree with you as a coach, then you do retain it.
Mm-hmm.
You get to keep it. Use it again. Recycle it.
For the, yeah.
We have an incredible day of roller derby here for you.
Amazing,
from ECDX
yes.
2019. This is just the beginning. Some big, big teams.
We start really early in the morning and we go until about 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah, I did the last bout last night, first bout this morning, and I'll do the last bout, which I know because I'm calling it and I'm really excited about it. Texas Crime City is at 6, 5:30, between 5:30 and 6 here on track 2. What else are you calling today, Rippy?
I've got so much. So right after this game at 10 a.m., we have Mars Jr. taking on the Philly Brawl Stars and Jersey Juniors. Mars and Philly on this track.
This track, yep.
And then Jersey Juniors and New Hampshire on track number 3.
Yep.
And then we have Black and Blue Gems and Philly All Stars on track 1. At 12, and Monadoc Juniors and the Dollars in Destruction on track 2, and then London taking on Santa Cruz on track 3.
Yeah, at about noon,
noon-ish.
We start to get some real heavy hitting,
yes.
high rankings,
right.
high stakes games going on. And I just noticed that Philly's jammer was sprung from the box, which means that, as we mentioned,
they
won
that.
Their official review.
Yep. So,
no power jam start here for Raleigh.
And we're looking up at the penalty.
Fina Colada, is that how you say it?
Fina Colada.
I think mm-hmm. is the jammer for Raleigh.
Mm-hmm. And although Fina is has been performing well out there, he can also wear the star.
Yeah, and they might just be looking for a little bit of a
mm-hmm. Oops. Little pile up there.
So we do have a little bit of whistle bleed over here on the other track. It sounds like the jam ended, but
I think that is going to be called on Fenia.
I think it was a track cut. That Dirty was, Dan.
I'm sorry. I'm just unfortunate because that pile up there, I think Fenia picked up that.
Yeah, it was a track cut. Dirty Dan completing his initial scoring pass for 4 points.
So Dirty Dan with the power jam and, of course, control of the track. And Raleigh getting pushed forward there. So the Philly Jammers are able to kind of take Raleigh's wall and move it up a little bit further. And so I think that would be another piece of advice I would say is lock down a little bit harder.
Yeah.
Not move so quickly out of the pack range.
But they have been doing, it does seem like, a better job of staying close together.
Mm-hmm. Maybe those coaches were giving the advice that you were suggesting.
Maybe.
Like, stay close together, friends. That's how you...
You are stronger together than apart. Oh.
Now, Fenia Colada is sitting. We have two penalties for Fenia Colada. I'm wondering if that last one was a... Were there two?
Yeah, it looks like it was a track cut at first and the forearm.
Fenia's been sitting for a while. I mean, I feel like that's longer than a minute for him.
But I just have to say, I am incredibly impressed with even like the blocking skills of Prim Reaper.
Mm-hmm.
Really incredible. And what's really exciting about the sport is that these are one of the first generations of young folks that are coming through having played roller derby for most of their life.
Right. Oh, no. And then there'd be another penalty on a blocker. Throw punch just giving a lot of trouble to, I think it's Bonnet. Yeah.
Yeah, that's Madison that is sitting in the penalty box, which I'm sure strategically Raleigh put the pivot cap on.
Yeah, absolutely.
Madison, so that there could be a potential pass. And now, unfortunately, number 151, who has been the jammer and accrued two penalties, Fenia Colada is on his own.
And, I think that's part of Philly's strategy is if a jammer... is having a difficult time with that defense. There is the star pass there from Fenia. If that jammer gets a penalty and they're sitting in the box, call the jam, because that jammer is going to have to come back out and contend with the defense and hasn't had a lot of success.
That was a really heads-up play there by number 411, Madison. One hand went out of bounds, which of course is not considered a track cut.
Mm-hmm.
Two hands?
Two hands is out of bounds, yes.
Yeah, you have to reset.
You have to reset.
Yep.
But just that one hand you can put down as long as you don't put two.
And I noticed yesterday during, I can't remember who they were playing, did Texas play yesterday? In any case, Haas the Boss is a master at knowing when she's only put one hand down and like can come back. And it was inspiring.
So we've got Sugar Cookies back out there. I just like that name too. Sugar Cookies taking on Ruby Katubi off the Frogmouth Jammer line. And Ruby Katubi now picking up a penalty. And so that will be a power jam for Philly. And Sugar Cookies just has to pick up lead here to get control of the track.
Yeah, and unfortunately for Raleigh, you just can't score when your jammer's not on the track. And there's been quite a few jammer penalties here in the second part of the first half. I do want to mention there was a big hit on Sugar Cookie there. And anybody that thinks that, you know, girls can't take... the stuff that the sort of body, that a male body can hit, just proves them wrong.
Oh, absolutely. These women can take it.
Yeah.
And can dish it.
Yes. So both of the blocker packs a little bit split up, and now all together now. Ruby Katubi goes down on one knee, is able to reset up number 9 for Philly. That is Megalass with a nice block to the in on Ruby Katubi.
One blocker to beat, and now that is the initial pass for Ruby Katubi. So eligible for points, but control of the track is with Sugar Cookies, and Sugar Cookies will call that.
Let's look up at what the 3 points there picked up on that second pass for Philly. That's 7 total in that jam, bringing us to 168-22 with 1:15 left in this half. Do you think there will be enough time for me to get a breakfast sandwich during halftime,
Rippy? You know what?
Rippy?
If you wanted to slip down and get yourself a breakfast sandwich, I would not even hold it against you.
It is early here in Feasterville, and we are going all day long, which I can't say I'm not incredibly excited for, because I am.
It just tends to take a toll on your self.
Yes! I'm so happy. I really have been wanting Raleigh to be able to pick up lead. That's
yes.
Madison, of course.
Again, that smooth crossover is by, and Wild One has that nice smooth crossover. And just, it's a very efficient way to keep that speed and keep control of your skates.
Sir Walter Raleigh working well to play offense to try and get Madison through. They were able to score at least 1 point, but I think that they are talking to the outside pack ref to see if maybe there was another point. I'm not sure.
Yeah, we're looking at the period clock. It's ticking down. We'll have to see if Loki Dookie will let us start this one. I think that's Loki Dookie. Let me look at my... Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
That's him.
Okay.
Oh. Loki Dookie was ready to start that jam, but it looks like our period clock ticked down just in time to...
Yeah.
Bring us to halftime.
We are at halftime here at track 2 at ECDX 2019. Right now, Philly Juniors are representing their the home league here at 170 to Raleigh Juniors at 23. But I will say that Raleigh has fought hard.
Yeah. I mean, they've made some good moves out there. I would love to be able to hear what the halftime conversation is, because I think a lot of the advice we've been talking about are things that the coaches will bring up.
Yeah. So we will see you back here in about 9 minutes.
Okay. Well, it is like, oh, hi.
Hi. Just talking about how difficult jamming is.
Yes.
And I at one point in time was a jammer, and I was just saying my lungs can handle blocking, maybe even every, but whew, jamming is a tough, tough position.
Jamming is tough, and it, especially against defense like Philly's. We've seen Philly just lock down the jammers of Raleigh here. And so even though Raleigh's had some good defensive plays, first of all, Philly's jammers are able to get out of the pack first, pick up lead.
They also have a really deep jammer bench.
Yes,
they have a lot of people that can wear that star and be effective.
Yes. And so Raleigh has sprinkled in a few other jammers trying to figure out what works best against this defense, which jamming style is able to get out of the pack. In terms of penalties, we're really close. There's a lot of parity here. Around 11 for Philly and 15. There may have been some shifting here. We've got a couple of question marks on the penalty tracker, but
yeah.
There may have been some shifting, but I'm sorry, 15 for Raleigh, 11 for Philly total. So it's really kind of a low...
Yeah,
penalty.
Low time to game. Especially for juniors. I was speaking with some officials yesterday that said one of the junior games there were almost 100 penalties between two teams. That's a lot of penalties.
Wow.
So
that would be a conversation I would have as a coach. If
yes.
I went with 100 penalties.
So here we are at 170 for Philly, 23 for Raleigh. We'll see if Raleigh's coaches have made a couple of adjustments, but you know, I think at this point Raleigh also looks at this as experience and what can we do better, what can we do different, how can we keep fighting, because the fight is half the battle.
Right. And I will say, like, most of the junior teams that I do tend to call juniors, and I do like watching their games, And the community surrounding juniors, Derby is about participating, is about learning, teamwork, is about those kinds of values that we hope that people bring to. So the junior teams typically have a good culture, I should say.
Yeah, yeah. It's been incredible to watch. Just I called last night. It wasn't on a live stream, but I called the Queen City versus Windy City, and the Queen City juniors had, I think all of them were there to support their yes. parent team and just went wild for them. And it was really lovely to see. And I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
This is why you bring, well, I mean, for the experience as well.
Right.
But you have your own cheering crowd.
Right. And, you know, they are very supportive. Because Raleigh's in my hometown and they come to the adult leagues, both men and women's, to make big signs and cheer them on, and then volunteer when they can. So, I mean, they...
Right. We should also mention in roller derby, a big part of roller derby is volunteering when you can, in not just in the derby community, but in the community at large.
Indeed, yes.
So, I think that...
As many are nonprofits, I believe. Many. They may not be all of them nonprofits, but many of them are 501c3s as nonprofits.
Yes, exactly. So instilling a lot of really great skills for these young folks to take with them as they go through the world.
Yeah. Really a big supporter of the Junior Derby.
Yeah. I, of course, skate and have coached for Maine. And we've tried really hard. It's just hard to find a venue that we can use.
Oh, that's everybody's problem, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it is. Especially, I think, for the smaller yeah. leagues that don't... Some larger leagues actually own their own spaces.
That would be my fantasy.
Yeah. All right. We have sugar yeah. cookies here, trying to beat the top of the pack for Raleigh, and does.
So, yeah, we were talking through that equipment check. We saw the equipment check happen at halftime, as we told you would happen. That's one I went at the front there for Philly. Again, TIE Fighter has been doing great work out there on defense. Also, I'd like to say TIE Fighter knows when to run up to play offense and then come back and support the wall. So a really good, that extra
yeah,
person that you were talking about.
Should be quick and deliberate and then end
and then
in a disengage.
Right.
Yes.
Do it, come back. Maybe do it again, come back. Yeah, so you see there. The little fist bump on the line.
And that's the captain.
Between the two.
No,
characters.
Not the captain. I'm sorry. That's Unstoppable. Jamming for Philly. And
Ruby Katibi out there
oh, yeah.
for Raleigh.
Oh, it's a back block.
Oh, my goodness.
On Unstoppable.
Right.
So the one thing that can stop Unstoppable is a penalty.
Right? Otherwise, Unstoppable is fairly unstoppable. And Ruby... out of the pack because that blocker did hit the infield. That was 8-17 boomerang.
All right. So this is a good start here for Raleigh. A power
yeah.
jam to start the second half. Raleigh doing a good job trying to swarm that defense and keep them apart and away mm-hmm. from Ruby Katibi.
Oh, everybody's just piled up there. Now Unstoppable released from the penalty box. So Katibi's going to call that off.
But not a bad idea to just keep Unstoppable off the track from
right,
scoring.
Right?
You know, so I think getting three and calling it to get Unstoppable off the track was a really smart move.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
So we got 28 facing off against 29.
Nice. And nobody is in the penalty box right now. Starting off on the Frogmouth Jammer line, 28 and 29. But, of course, that is Bonnet able to get lead for Philly.
Very quickly before the pivot line even. Now finding an outside.
Oh my.
And then swerves to the inside. Makes
and that
it through.
Was like, that was like the picture-perfect thing
yeah.
of what we were talking about with the big hits. And then you kind of go down. But
I will say, Bells has been, well, now that's three jams, I believe. And effective on some of them, ineffective on some of them. So maybe
one more look at
the defense there. She might be able to figure out a way through there. But
Yeah, exactly. Definitely has been successful sometimes.
Right. Now, they've done a good job of locking down Madison here, which we talked about earlier.
Yeah, Madison, an incredibly skilled jammer.
When she's able to get out, she's able to do some things. But they have Philly has done a good job of hanging on to her and really making sure she doesn't get out.
Dirty Dan here does a nice little spin
move.
Yeah,
nice move there.
Well played there by number 101. That extra again. Trey, is it?
101, TIE Fighter.
Yes, TIE Fighter. Playing that essential role of bridge between the packs there.
If we were giving out MVPs, that's a name I would put forth.
Unfortunately, sometimes when you do that, which I think... No, never mind. I'm sorry. I couldn't see who's in the box right now, but that is number...
Three, I think. Rainbow Bash?
93. Nah.
Oh, 934. Yeah. The big hit. Yeah, I'm sorry. You're right. You were talking
about it. And again, we can't really describe to you what we're seeing this through, but it is a chain link fence and then another and then a net.
Yes. So our view is a little obscured, but not. I mean, we can still see the track. But while we were talking, unfortunately, Madison picked up a penalty. I believe I'm waiting for it to come up here before I speak. Yeah, cut track. And so. This is a power jam for Philly. Now, that's another quick Rainbow Bash back in the penalty box. That was not even 30 seconds on the track. Rainbow Bash reporting back to the box for Philly.
Dirty Dan through again here. This is going to be another big jam for Philly. 16 so far on the scoreboard. Really a pretty move on 1 foot there by Dirty Dan.
Oh, they're hanging on to him, but...
Nicely done.
Mm.
Unfortunately, 934 went out of bounds, and
right.
So Dirty Dan knew he could come back in.
That was one of those big hits. Even though she controlled it a little bit more in that time,
A valiant effort, for sure. This is going to be Philly's, I believe, second 24-point jam of the game, bringing it to 206 to 26. Similar numbers... A lot of points in between.
Mm-hmm.
We have an official timeout here. It looks like Raleigh's coach is just double checking maybe either some points or I'm not sure.
Yeah. Yeah, it looks like some of our skating officials are touching base with some of the
non-skating officials.
No, I'm sorry, track.
Which is a great opportunity for us to let you know who our officiating staff is.
Yeah.
For non-skating officials, we have Carried Away. We have War Marine, Muffin, Ms. Hyde, Snippy Snap, Ianfluenza, Loki Doki, Moon Shimmer, Jams Joyce, Pete in the Pool. Do you want to take us through our skating officials?
Sure. The officials on skates are Shanksy, Grampus, Junior, John Dilks, Frito, Janus, Axis of Siebel, and Zero.
And roller derby truly would not exist without the incredible volunteers, both on skates and non-skating officials allow this sport to exist.
I know you see there, when we have this many players on the track and when you're looking at scores and penalties and how much time is in the box? I mean, it just takes an army of volunteers to do this. And
I can't think of another sport that requires sort of this many eyes on. Can you?
Just to play, right? Like, I know that there are sports that have people that do, like, individuals stat tracking. So I will, you know, look at this one player stat tracking. And so maybe they have a large crew. But in terms of just regular gameplay, I'm not sure.
Yeah. No, it's a big crew, and they, you know, there is a larger derby community, but certainly there is a lot of friendship and camaraderie between the officiating derby community as well. We are still here in an official timeout, which gives us the opportunity to thank the Derby Apex, which is your independent source for women's flat track derby news, rankings, and more. you can visit thederbyapex.com and follow them on Twitter at @thederbyapex, which also gives me the opportunity to tell you, you can also track live stats now. This weekend has been the rollout of stats.wftda.com, and it's going to really change, I think, how we look at roller derby. I made a joke to Gretchen yesterday. I was like, do you think there's going to be fantasy roller derby?
Yeah.
Could be.
I believe there is a fantasy roller derby happening.
Really?
If you would like to tell us about it,
yes,
you can tweet us. You can tweet us at #ECDX2019. Or we are also, we have some folks looking at social media, and we are also monitoring the #talk2WFTDA. So both of those you can use, or do them both. I mean,
yeah,
put all the hashtags that you need.
We wish you could speak directly to us,
right,
but the Wi-Fi and the we are in a,
yes,
black hole of Wi-Fi and
no cell service.
Correct.
So when you come into ECDX, you are here in what we call the tournament bubble.
Yeah.
And you do not leave the tournament bubble.
And it's nice, you know, it really does force folks to be real present, mm-hmm, which, you know, I think is a hot commodity these days.
It does. It is sort of like you come out at the end of the night going, what day is it?
Yeah, exactly.
But it's fun because you get to come in here and sort of be in your space, and lots of friends here and lots of reunions happening and people we haven't seen in a while. And
there has been an official review that went from a official timeout to an official review.
And that is being called by Raleigh, it looks like.
Yep.
I'm watching Loki Doki here. See when that timer...
And we'll see. Generally, when we don't have somebody running down, I just kind of look and see, is anybody being sent to the box?
Yeah, and always looking for... Okay, so we know that they did not retain,
yep,
that review. So whatever they were asking for, they did not receive.
Which puts us with Ruby Katubi on the line for Raleigh and Wild One jamming for Philly with a nice one-footed move on the outside.
Just really impressed with Philly here in all the ways. The defense has been really strong and together. And the offense, you see the jammers are just very skilled at keeping their balance and,
yes,
withstanding hits and just finding a lane and sometimes doing toe-stop dancing
and
whatever
they
need.
That was a nice reset. Wild One knew that a little piece of her skate had gone out of bounds and thus needed to reset. That was a good attempt.
Yep.
Oh, and it's not an attempt. It is a drawn cut call here, number 29. That is Els Bells ran
nice
back on Wild
job
One and
yeah
forced that track cut.
Really nice awareness there to see that there was a step out on the line and to just draw back. So that was a really good move there one time to draw back that jammer and get
it
her
used
out
to happen a lot more often until jammers got really pretty savvy to knowing when they needed to come out. So that was a really well done by Els Bells.
So looks like Ruby Katubi is in. We'll pick up
track.
A cut track. Yep.
Same
just
thing
like,
happened.
Getting a little frustrated there. Coming through the pack, and then that's what happens. You get frustrated and you pull a track cut there.
Yep, so we'll go the full 2 minutes, although we are almost there.
Yeah.
Wild One back on the track, of course, now on a scoring pass here. Already with 8 on the board. That's going to bring us to 12.
And so that does not allow Ruby Katubi to exit the box, so that means she will head out again as jammer,
mm-hmm,
and that is unfortunate because we did see a little frustration on her face as she came through.
Which could be a the jam ran out, so not a strategic move necessarily, just a happenstance.
Just a happenstance, yeah.
Philly is sending 2 people, I believe. So trying to see the number. They were sending an offensive person and the jammer. The jammer able to secure lead.
So that was 31 that actually got out. Susan B. Anarchy.
And TIE Fighter lining up with Susan B. Anarchy. Again, as that extra to try and help.
Eye of the Storm. Oh, tries to run some interference and gets a little interference there too.
You should, something that's interesting, I think, is that, you know, of course, there are often siblings that play the same sports, but in roller derby, I think it's great when any gender sibling can play with each other, you know?
Yeah. You need to learn a lot about your sibling that way. So we do have one blocker apiece in the penalty box.
Yes, that's a low block there on TIE Fighter. Unfortunately, with low blocks, they're kind of a tricky penalty, even if you really, really don't mean to commit them.
Yes.
If it has an impact on the game, you're going to go to the box, even if really you can't avoid it.
Yeah. Yeah, there have been some unfortunate times when low blocks have been called, which is true. It was a low block, but, you know, just, you know, tripping over, you know, people falling, and it just, it's unfortunate sometimes. So, TIE Fighter standing in the box now. We
waving his fingers, for he's got 8 seconds left. That's what he's telling his coach.
I'm looking to see. There is a blocker for Raleigh. I cannot see who it is from this vantage, but.
Yeah, they're going to start with only three. Three-on-three pack here to start this jam. Jam number 7 of this half. We're about 20 minutes left.
And that's Bonnet.
Yeah, that is.
A jammer we've seen many times out here for Philly, doing a great job for them. Comes into the pack, and it takes a big hit, but withstands it, and is just right back up.
Oh, my.
Nice.
What beautiful footwork by Bonnet.
And TIE Fighter coming, popping out of the penalty box, is in there running interference, and the jammer for Raleigh, one hand down. Ugh. And then they finish her off. Yeah.
Number 888, that's Harley Spin, is like, as soon as you stand up. Because, of course, you can't hit a down skater.
Right.
But as soon as you pop back up, I'm going to hit you right out.
Nice hit there by, I believe that was Assassinator, but Bonnet able to take it. Stays in bounds on the outside lane there. Just I'm always impressed by the hits they can take.
Yeah, me too. Me too.
And
stay on their feet.
Yeah, just keep standing up. That might be a feature of the fact that this is the last day and I'm super tired. But I feel like they are taking a lot of hits, and I could not withstand this.
Well, the other thing that I noticed yesterday when I was calling a level 3 junior roller derby game is one or two of the jammers for those teams were going every other. The endurance that requires is just... you can't put it into words, actually. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what it would have been like as a young person, but as an adult, I am just impressed with that.
Right. So I'd like to give a shout out here. That's Boomerang. And Boomerang is like one of those solid players. It's always there in the wall, holding down the wall, but also able to just find that jammer. It's like Boomerang's hips never leave the jammer. And, you know, she's always aware. Now here she's holding back a defensive player to try to open up that wall. But, I mean, we do have a Shortcut did receive a penalty, is serving time for a back block. So that allows Boomerang to just do some other work out there. But just her presence out there is just everywhere.
And
just,
you know,
everywhere.
And likely is also probably doing a lot of communicating on the track, letting her team know, you know, I'm right here, or we need to, you know, whatever needs to be said, really.
So Philly has the two. Okay, there we go. So there is a, this is a power start for Philly. Shortcut still in the box standing, but not on the track yet.
That, of course, is unstoppable, jamming for Philly.
So they will draw back Shortcut a little bit off the line, and that gives enough room for Unstoppable to be unstoppable.
Apex jump by Unstoppable. Made it look easy.
Shortcut
holy
through the pack
moly
on the initial, but Unstoppable again being unstoppable.
Yeah, and it's like almost like he has magic eye and can just anticipate where people are going to move and then slice and dice through without being touched.
Now, Takedown Diva did pick up a penalty there at the end of that. I believe it was a forearm, I want to say. So we'll start one blocker down, a slight track advantage to Raleigh. One blocker down for Philly.
I believe that this is the captain for Philly, number 20, jamming Dirty Dan.
Yes, and that's
a nice teamwork there by Raleigh to take him out of bounds.
Yeah, the thing about the Philly jammers that I've noticed is Raleigh will take them all the way almost to the line.
Mm-hmm.
But they literally might have an inch or two, but that's all they need, really.
Mm-hmm.
And they are able to stay in bounds on that one toe stop and get through. And so Raleigh, I think, needs to bring them all the way to the line, as his.
And as you said that, literally, the move happened on that one toe stop with literally 2 inches.
Literally, yeah. I mean, just 1 or 2 inches, that's all Philly needs to, the Philly jammers need to get through. And so Raleigh's got to come all the way to the line when they're blocking, like all bring that toe stop all the way out.
And, you know, I'm sure some junior derby skaters do this too, but even some of the higher level derby skaters right now are even able to sort of jump the straightaway.
Yeah.
And so even if you get all the way to the line, they like, it's just incredible.
Yes, they can do like a, they can throw their weight around you. But I would much rather ask someone on my opposing team to try to attempt that than to not bring them all the way to the line.
Right.
I've been calling that a straight pex jump.
I love that. I love that. That's like mine, my thing. Yeah, it was a peg assist without the assist. It's a peg. Wild one is jamming for Philly.
That was good. That was good.
On their, her second scoring pass, but the Raleigh jammer has made it out of the pack.
I do love wordplay, so
yes.
I'm a fan of that. So.
And Philly says, okay, we're going to call that. I know that I got all of my points on that pass, bringing it 8 in the jam for Philly, 269 total to 34. And, you know, Raleigh went on a little bit, you know, they were able to score, you know, 20 or more of their points in the earlier part of the first half. And since then, Philly has just
locked them down.
Yeah. But they continue to fight and fight hard.
And I love, all junior teams, but just because I happen to know this team, they've kind of grown up together.
Mm-hmm.
So I love watching them use one another out there because they know each other so well. They'll just take their friend and put them where they need that friend to be, and they don't have any problems moving their teammates around. I mean, they literally have grown up together, you know, and they just kind of have a trust with one another that you don't often have.
And how long have you been announcing Junior Derby?
Since I started? I've only been announcing about 2.5 years, maybe.
Okay.
And so came on Junior. I had to learn a little bit about the level 2 and 3 because I wasn't sure about all the differences, but... It's every bit as exciting to me as now that was a nice drawback all the way to the line there.
Yes.
So that it drove the jammer out of bounds, and that was a good defensive move there. So I'm glad they're listening to me.
Maybe they can hear you. We have Madison. Madison, yes, Madison, able to take advantage of a split up pack and get lead for Raleigh there.
Oh. So Ruby Katibi does take the jammer out of bounds.
Yes!
Steps out of bounds, but is able to get
jump.
There.
Jump! Holy moly!
My goodness.
For goodness sake, Madison, that was beautiful.
And they're squishy, taking the jammer all the way to the line. So that's what you got to do. Take them to the line.
Oh, and Madison threw for another four. I say that even though she hasn't passed these two jammers, because she did, I believe, pass them before.
Yeah, and oh, okay. So yeah, the blocker went in bounce too. Okay. So yeah, another four.
Nice.
So we're getting some points here for Raleigh, which I'm.
This is potentially going to approach their highest scoring jam, I think. And I'm not surprised that it is coming from Madison. But now that's Philly lock wall.
She's locked down again in the very similar position that she was in earlier. There's that stop position, and anywhere Madison goes at that point.
So what you see right now, the Philly blocker, that is, I'm not sure who that is, but is putting their arm up just to show that there is not a multiplayer block going on right there. That was
exactly.
Number 9, Megalass. And, you know, I see that Madison's tired. I might go ahead and call it, even though I know the Philly jammer has had to pass it. You just don't want – you want to carry that momentum rather than have Madison go to the box because she's tired.
And unfortunately, at that time, Madison, we saw this this same exact point on the track. When you go to the line, that is your danger. The tripod collapses onto the line, and you can fall out of bounds or you can step out of bounds.
Yep.
You got to go out of bounds.
In my
there's not any other choice.
In my league from Maine, we call that the sad place.
Yes.
You
want to
put the jammer in the sad place. All right, we have sugar cookies here.
Sugar cookies.
Yeah, and shortcut.
Sugar cookie makes that Raleigh collapsing now. Now there, shortcut right back to that place on the line.
Right, but that was boomerang, as you mentioned before.
Yes.
Just not giving any room.
And look and see, like, boomerang is just so like aware of where the track is to cut the distance between herself and the jammer, and just able to like get. I mean, she was almost right in front of shortcut as he came around, blocked him on one side, and was in front of him as he came out the other side. Just really nice movement there.
We should mention that coming up on this track next is actually another Philly Juniors team. I believe it's their level 2, which is the middle level between 1 and 3. Duh.
But you should watch it because the differences between them are really interesting. I mean, it's just really interesting to watch. I mean,
What you should understand is likely all of these skaters that are on here at one time played level 2 as well.
Yes.
Yes.
And
Els
that
Bells.
Is Els Bells as lead.
A little bit of a run here for Raleigh. I'm loving it.
Unstoppable. Also out of the pack, though.
Now they're going to race it because they know they need to score a couple points. Call it quick. We'll see what.
I don't know. Unstoppable may have slipped.
Got one.
Through. Got one.
One.
So level 2, if you've never seen it, they cannot accelerate into a hit. In other words, they can lean in to another person, but they cannot like take, go into them with a hit. And so, I really am impressed with officials that can call that level of derby because
it's a different skill set.
You have to tell like when is an acceleration and when it's not. And so there's a lot more positional blocking happening in a level 2 derby. And so it's just really fascinating to watch.
It's Bonnet, of course, your lead jammer for Philly against Madison, back on the track for Raleigh. That's a direction of gameplay on Ty Fighter.
Ty Fighter doing great work out there, but did pick up that direction. And Madison is out of the pack as Philly sends another blocker to the box. That's number 15, Motley Drew.
It'll be really interesting to see as these highly skilled level 3 skaters age out, if it influences where they want to go to college, you know, with what derby team they want to play on potentially. I'm sure that that's going to happen.
I mean, I feel like... it might have an influence on where they ultimately
like which city they like, choose to look.
Jammer's out. Now, the lead has been assessed to Shortcut. Shortcut is in the back, in the gray jersey. That is Dirty Dan, both captains of their teams.
That was beautiful. That was really fun to watch.
Yeah.
Because they also skate very similarly.
Yeah. And just a race there.
Raleigh doing a great job the past couple of jams, either keeping it, you know, this like a neutral sort of jam, 0-0, 1-1.
Mm-hmm.
Madison able to pick up those 10 points. Just about 6 minutes left here.
So unfortunately, that last direction call for Throat Punch Thursday, you see Throat Punch in the box, brings her to five. So we're only about just under 6 minutes left in this half, in the second half. So not incredibly in danger, but it is certainly something that she needs to watch as we head into the final minutes of this half.
Oh my, what a pretty, that's 29. Els Bells has been very impressive to me tonight too, or tonight.
Tonight, I mean, it feels like
this morning.
We've been here for
we were here last night.
But we were here last night, yeah. So. So that was Wild One. But again, Els Bells has found something.
Yes. And only four
to do,
on that, you know.
Right?
4-0 on a jam is certainly, you know, optimal, obviously,
mm-hmm.
to something like 24.
Mm-hmm.
So good job by both teams. Good job by Raleigh to sort of figure out a defense that's working a little better for them.
Yeah, I'm, sometimes I... Oh, my goodness, a little pileup there. Ruby Katubi falls on the jammer. That's Susan B. Anarchy, but no penalty assessed there. I think it was just a... People just fell, and that's when that happens.
Yep. People fall in roller derby.
People fall. That is what happens. So Anarchy pushing against the front, and they're a spin, and Shortcut out. That's Fina Colada picking up a penalty.
Good for Raleigh.
Anarchy's like, I'm not gonna do this chase foot race here with Shortcut, and so sometimes it's just wise to call that off. And Phillies, you know, very comfortable lead, not worry about it. They don't have to tire their people out or risk injury or penalty or any of that stuff. They've got room to really sit back. And
you know, another asset for these junior teams that you know we're gonna start to see is that we're broadcasting these, so they have footage of themselves to watch that can really inform sort of strategy or gameplay. Or it's amazing.
And they will. They will absolutely watch this, I'm quite sure. Oh! that was some acrobatics right there, let me tell you. Test High Fighter doing the balancing act on the high wire.
And, you know, I love seeing a smaller... but like incredible blocker.
Yeah. You do not want to be up against TIE Fighter. That was so great.
So here we go. We got Sugar Cookies coming in on their second.
I also would not want to be in a limbo contest with TIE Fighter.
Yeah.
Because that was amazeballs.
Very Gumby-esque.
Yeah.
So coming up after this is the Philly Brawl Stars again, and you did just such a nice job explaining what that level two meant versus the Mars Junior Roller Derby. I'm not sure where Mars is from.
You know what? If you hadn't asked me right this second, I would have been able to tell you, but I, my brain is kind of not enough coffee yet, and...
Yeah, and we've already called almost an entire game. We've only got 2 minutes and a half left here. Again, there's TIE Fighter just getting in the way of anyone that he can.
Now, the star has been passed for Raleigh to Throat Punch Thursday. Throat Punch Thursday doing a lot of great defensive work. As a jammer, not as effective against the Philly defense, but certainly as a blocker has given them a lot of trouble. Throw Punch is sitting on five right now, but five penalties. But only 2 minutes left in the
I don't know if you all can hear that, but there was a really nice and big applause, which goes just to the point that you made. The community for Junior Roller Derby is so supportive. Mm-hmm. People turn out to watch.
I don't know if the, your camera view actually shows the crowd, but we're full about this. Yep. This track two is so the audience is kind of sitting off to one
now
side.
Now you can see them. You can see them right there.
It's a packed house. We do have the bleachers don't look as full, but when you look at the inside, the people have chosen to sit inside the track, of course. I mean, why would you sit outside the glass if you can sit inside the track, right?
Dirty Dan potentially going to close this. Oh, no, I'm sorry. That's Unstoppable. Going to close this potentially out for Philadelphia. Madison. No,
that's Els Bells, who has been effective against this. And I'm not even really, like, I haven't been able to isolate from myself, from my vantage point, what it is that she's figured out. But she has figured out something.
Yeah. And that was a 4-6 jam again, 49-312. Only a 2-point differential. Great job by Raleigh to get their jammer out.
Mm-hmm. We do have enough time on the game clock to have another jam.
Yep.
And so everybody's setting up for that. We'll hear from Loki Doki as soon as everybody gets in. There we go. And there's the call. So we will get another jam.
Of course, only two blockers on the track right now for Philly. There are two sitting in the box.
Oh, but still, that's Bonnet out as lead jammer. Shortcut wearing the star for Raleigh, but if you'll notice, Boomerang is out there on the track.
There we go. Shortcut is out.
And I suspect Philly will run. Oh, they did not run the clock out.
Yeah, they may. They may call a timeout. We'll see what they. No, we're showing unofficial, but
we're showing the unofficial score. As 49-316 in favor of Philly.
Yep. We'll see. We got to wait, though, round whistle.
The teams have 30 seconds after the end to
show you a little bit
review.
Of the crowd
here.
Yeah,
so you see, it is a packed house. Like, I know when you were looking at the bleachers, it wasn't. But we are full in track two.
Yeah, and it is just going to get more full today. Day three at ECDX 2019. We get that final whistle that tells us the final score is indeed 316-49. Mm-hmm. Philly versus Raleigh level 3 junior derby.
Yes. It's been, you know, I really am. I'm always impressed by their heart and their determination. And even when they were down a significant number of points, Raleigh just never quit putting up the big defense, trying to get their jammers out, running offense, interference, and
you got a little Raleigh Mama Bear pride
I've got some Mama Bear pride.
I think that's awesome.
Right.
So this has been lovely, a lovely way to wake up with you, Rippy. Stay tuned. There's great derby all day coming up on this track. Next is, again, Mars Juniors, Philly Brawl Stars Juniors. That's level 2 on track 3, which is also broadcast. We have Jersey Juniors, also level 2, versus New Hampshire Juniors. And then as we get into the noon hour, we start to have some heavy rankings influencing games.
Right. So we will have some level 3 bouts at noon, but then we do have London taking on Santa Cruz at noon as well.
And what you can count on is that some of these games later this afternoon are absolutely going to affect the rankings in the WFTDA. Mm-hmm. You can keep up to date with those in live time at stats.wftda.com. Check back after every game and see how people are doing.
That's right. Thank you for joining us this morning. I'm Rippy Longstocking.
I'm Be Nimble.
And we'll
Take
see you
care.
Soon. Bye-bye.